If you're law enforcement, stop and listen to me right now. If you're a police department that does not have an LPR system, Insight is offering the first 10 agencies, that means one agency apiece, gets one camera for free. You have to tell them that Two Cops, One Donut sent you. You heard me right. If you're a police agency that does not have an LPR system yet, or does have an LPR system, and you're not happy with the product you have, Insight is offering you a free camera. No strings attached, and they will install it. I have 10 to give out. Tell them Two Cops, One Donut sent you, or reach out to me, and I will get you in contact. If you're a business owner or an HOA, please stop and listen to me right now. If you're just listening to the audio, do yourself a favor and watch the YouTube version of this episode to get a visual of what I'm about to tell you. I want to tell you guys about Insight LPR. It's a license plate reader. If your agency, community, or business is looking to invest in LPR to help solve and deter crime, or to make your community safer, Insight LPR has my vote of confidence. I've met with their team. They know their LPRs, guys. They're the real deal. They bring over 75 years of collective experience to building LPR cameras and the software that supports communities across the country. The other thing I really like about this team is how much they listen to law enforcement. They understand the importance of working together with law enforcement and getting their input as they build and innovate products and their service to match the needs of law enforcement. In other words, when I complain or have suggestions to make their damn camera better, they actually do it. The Insight LPR team is extremely passionate and takes pride in their product development, which makes their cameras some of the most durable cameras in the market. For the gear nerds out there, what that means is this stuff's made of military grade aluminum and is nitrogen purged, whatever that means. This design makes the cameras rugged and able to withstand harsh weather elements. Here's the big selling point for me. Their nighttime scan accuracy is higher than most of the leading competitors. In my opinion, this is what sets them apart. As we know, the majority of crimes occur at night, so it's critical to have high scan accuracy at night. Insight's cameras check the box with the nighttime plate read accuracy greater than 96%. 96%, guys. That's pretty freaking high. If your community is looking to invest in LPR technology, reach out to one of their experts today or reach out to me. Tell them Two Cops, One Donut sent you. Hey, folks. Eric Levine from Two Cops, One Donut. Want something better than Ring, Arlo, Brink, or any of the other quick launch home security systems? I've been having trouble with my Ring products. They don't read license plates on moving vehicles, the link doesn't connect fast enough to my phone, and I'm tired of getting notifications only to see like a glimpse of something that set it off. I was reached by a veteran-owned business called Agent Security. The owner, the staff, all veterans or former cops, they're kind of like the Chick-fil-A of customer service when it comes to security. They have a system that does everything companies like Ring do and more. They have pivoting cameras that track day or night. They can also read license plates and catch high definition details that will lead police more effectively to catching the offender. Their mission is providing the best home security systems to their customers. All you have to do is start the conversation to protect our most valuable assets, our families. They listen to your needs and come up with perfect customized security solutions to protect what matters to you most. You can contact them by phone at 713-962-3558 or email info@agentsecurity.com or visit their website, agentsecurity.com. That's agentsecurity.com. They serve the greater Houston area, North Texas, and more. Be sure to tell them that Eric Levine from Two Cops, One Donut sent you. This episode of the podcast is brought to you by MPAC Tactical. MPAC is a tactical outfitter for the men and women of our military, police, fire departments, and other public safety around the country. MPAC's core beliefs is that fearless men and women protect our freedom and safety should have access to the best tactical performance apparel, equipment, and tools on the market. And they shouldn't have to go broke to get it. I've used MPAC for about 11 years, and I can attest that they do live up to their core values. So you get a personal recommendation from me. You can find them at mpactactical.com. That's mpactactical.com. And be sure to tell them that Two Cops, One Donut sent you. This episode of the podcast is brought to you by HRH Combat Arms. They can turn your vision into reality. They specialize in gunsmithing and Cerakoting. Your Cerakote specialist is Air Force veteran and retired police sergeant Paul Ware, a.k.a. the Sarge. He can Cerakote your firearms, auto parts, tools, even your sports equipment. This veteran-owned business is located at 5025 Saunders Suite 103, Fort Worth, Texas 76119. You can call them at 682-304-0363. And you can find them online at www.hrhcombatarms.com. That's www.hrhcombatarms.com. All right, welcome back to Cops One Donut. I'm your host, Eric Levine. Today, I got with me Air Force veteran, canine expert, coffee expert, Shane McNamara. How's it going, buddy?
I'm doing awesome. It's been a long time since you and I talked, man. I think it's been over a year.
Yeah, well, you decided to be all you can be unofficially and go do some Black Ops stuff, training dogs in other countries.
Yeah, I kind of had to disappear off the globe for a little while. That was crazy. So we ended up getting a subcontract from the U.S. government to train 8 working dogs in the country of Palau. Originally, we were supposed to give them bomb dogs and drug dogs, but it turned out to be all just drug dogs. No, I forgot. It was half. We gave them 2 bomb dogs and the rest were drug dogs. Where it changed was we originally were going to pick dual purpose dogs for them, but then they realized that they didn't have a need to, you know, send the dogs on the locals and like be biting people. It's a bad image for the government. So they kicked that to the curb.
Yeah.
But the whole thing was crazy. Probably one of the most stressful things I've ever done. It could have been an easy gig, but one of the lessons I learned was screening the people before you go out and like do something big like that. You really need to know your crew. You need to be super tight knit with everybody and people you can trust. So I ended up, you know, with some strangers basically that I didn't know that I hired, and it almost turned into a shit show trying to manage these adults. To do things, and it was almost a nightmare, but it ended up getting completed. So we successfully completed that contract, and in turn of doing that contract, you know, I had to delete my Facebook, I had to disappear, and I kind of just fell off the globe, because like with, you know, drug interdiction, especially with, you know, a country I've never been to, I don't know who's in charge there, what they're, you know, how fucking dangerous are these dudes, like are they going to try to cut my head off on the island when I start stopping all their meth trade, you know, and it was just, I was like, I need to protect my family. So I just disappeared for a while.
Yeah. I remember it. Like I was sending messages to you, I think on Instagram or something like that, just because you had the coffee thing going on and everything. Yeah. And I, you know, friends, I just try to support their businesses and whatnot while they're, whatever they got going on. And you were blowing up with the canine training and the coffee thing all at the same time. So I was like, well, let me help, you know, Air Force buddy get his stuff out there. And then all of a sudden, dude, you just were gone.
I felt like I was on the top of the mountain at that time, and I was. And then going and doing the contract and those people that I hired, just, I don't know if you've ever worked with people that were like serial narcissists or been around human beings that are that way. I lost a good portion of who I was during that contract, being around those people that didn't have my best interest at hand. And I ended up, you know, just being spread too thin, trying to do everything. And I ended up losing the coffee company, the relations with the manufacturer. So my coffee company was basically built upon another pre-existing coffee that was out there. But what they were doing is they were packaging and labeling my brand on some of their existing products.
Oh, so, did you know that?
Yeah, I knew that. And I was cool with that because their products were so amazing. Yeah. And, you know, it's in the industry, there's, you know, everybody does that. Great Value, you know, Walmart brand. They're just,
yeah. Oreo Cookie does that.
Yeah, it's called white labeling. And it allows them to sell double the amount of their product with another label on it because person's buying into the brand.
Right.
So, you know, I talked to that company and I had them doing it and we started getting tons of sales. And then this company, I don't know, something flipped and they just got upset. Maybe, I don't know. The relations fell apart. They were packaging everything. They were doing all the work and I was just sitting and collecting cash. I don't know.
Yeah.
So the relationship started falling apart. And then I think one of the guys that I hired on the canine contract was like secretly trying to sabotage me and going behind my back to destroy my relationships and stuff. It got pretty crazy.
Damn.
It's almost so much that like when I got back almost for a year after that contract, I had some serious like depression. I had some serious trauma from primarily the three individuals that I hired for that contract. They basically formed together to create like a mutiny situation where they wanted to do everything their way, or they threatened to destroy the whole contract on me.
Damn.
It was insane. It was like a union formed against me, and I couldn't get these people to do the things I needed them to do. Or, you know, one guy was advertising his company while he was out there the whole time.
It
was the worst thing I've ever experienced in my life. But, you know, when I look at things, I've become a little more religious in life, and I just felt like it was God preparing me for anything now, because how difficult and hard and stressful that government contract was. It's like everything else from that point forward, nothing even scratches the surface of stress and difficulty. I can have like, you know, this person freaking out and this happening and a dog running over here and this, and I'm just cool and calm because I've been through some shit, you know? And then I think our military background and the stuff that I went through too helped with my bearing of like, you know, don't freak out, stay calm, breathe, assess the situation and react.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So it really played pivotal.
All right, brother. Well, let's get to the format here. So, I like to do a little humanizing portion first. You're a person of service. You were in the military service. You continue to serve through canine training, and being a small business owner. Again, that helps serve communities, especially for you. You're still basically in a law enforcement and military capacity through what you're doing, but I want people to understand how you got to that point. So, who are you, where are you from, and what drew you to, a life of service, you know, getting into the military and stuff like that?
Yeah. My story is a little crazy, man. I grew up, you know, with fragmented parents, moving around from place to place, not because, you know, they were military. They just moved around and, you know, divorced at an early age. Father was a drug addict. Mother was literally a stripper. Like, this is crazy stuff, man. I'm going to get into it with you and the world to hear my story. So, you know, I struggled through high school. I basically barely passed with like a 2.0. You know, I just couldn't get with school. I couldn't understand why they wanted me to teach me these different things like algebra. Like, why do I have to learn this? I just didn't go with the program. So I'd sleep through classes and maybe just take tests. You know, pretty much that story of the kid that everyone thought is just not going to make it, right? He doesn't get with the program. He doesn't do anything. So I went, you know, I ended up graduating high school, like I said, with a 2.0. And then right when I graduated, I got into a terrible motorcycle accident at about 75 miles per hour. And I ended up becoming partially paralyzed. So my head went this way and my shoulder went down, and I separated what's called a brachial plexus nerve group. And it paralyzed me for an entire year. So I was bedridden for the first year. It was literally like 2 days after graduation, I paralyzed myself and I was bedridden. You know, luckily my mom took care of me for that time period, and I ended up making a long story short, making a full recovery from that first motorcycle accident. Then I moved out to Texas on my own, and I was living with family members to family members, hopping, you know, couch hopping. And basically I didn't know what the hell I was doing with my life. Like, I was trying to work different jobs, and, you know, here in Texas, you know, that store Conn's.
Yeah.
I worked at a Conn's trying to do commission sales, like force people to buy washers and dryers when I was 18. Because if you go in that store, those salesmen are ruthless, dude. Have you ever been in a Conn's?
I have never been to a Conn's.
Don't step foot in there, man. Like, hey, Conn's, don't sue me for this. But like, if you go in there, like, I mean, maybe it's changed from when I was there, but we would stick on a customer until that person got angry and told us to like fuck off. Because we're trying to sell them so much, you know, so many things, because we were commissioned salesmen and we had to meet quota. So I worked at those places like that, and I still couldn't make enough money to make my, you know, ends meet. And then, you know, I'd live with my aunt and uncle. It would come up on 6 months to a year, and they're like, hey, you need to go get your own place, you know, like, you know, they're trying to push me out. And I couldn't make enough money to, you know, work in these jobs to afford apartment rent, gas, all this stuff, you know. So I was bouncing around, and then eventually I was like, screw it, I'm going to try to get into the military. So I originally walked straight into a Navy recruiter's office, and they gave me such disrespect. Like, I was 20 at the time, and I walked in there, and they were like, how old are you? And I was like, oh, I'm 20, about to be 21. And then they were like, you know, we're really looking for kids that are just, you know, coming out of high school right now. That's what we're really looking for right now. That's what the guy said to me.
During the time of war.
Yeah, during a time of war. And I was like, okay, so you guys don't think that I'm too old or what? He's like, yeah, we're just kind of looking for high schoolers right now, you know, that are coming out fresh. And I was like, he was just, and he was probably more rude than that and gave me such a cold shoulder that I was like, man, fuck this. And then I went over, I was like, you know, I'm not going to go join the Marines just because I didn't want to do that. Like, you know, it's not something I was interested in. And then I went over to the Air Force recruiter and I talked to him, and he basically was like, we got a whole bunch of jobs. We can do this and that. And I told him, like, you know, a year ago I was paralyzed in a motorcycle accident. And he was like, ooh, so you've got like surgeries and stuff like that. And I was like, yeah, my knee and all these other things. And I was like, and my arm was paralyzed for a year. And I said, but sir, like, I'm in perfect shape. Like, I can drop down right now and give you 150 pushups without stopping. And he was like, all right, well, if you can drop down and give me 150 pushups right now, I'll figure out a way to get you in. So I dropped down, nailed out 150 pushups. I was like on 148, 149, face turning red, snot coming out of my nose.
That's a rough number.
Yeah, dude, it was insane. Like, because I picked like an insane number to try to prove myself.
Right.
And then I went and I did it. And he was like, damn, you know, I'll see what I can do. So he ended up pulling all my medical stuff, getting waivers for my arm, for my knee. You know, maybe some of it, I don't know what he did, but he got me in. And then I told him, I said, man, I got pretty much nowhere to live. Like, I'm surfing couches. Like, I need a home. And he was like, you need a home? I'm like, yeah, I'm almost homeless, man. Like, give me a job. And then
security forces, baby.
No, so this is what's funny is the job he was going to give me was a POL, right? Fuels.
Oh, fuels. Yeah.
Yeah. He was going to give me fuels, but then I psyched myself out, not, you know, being uneducated. I didn't even know anything about what the military was like before I went in the military. The only person that was in the military in my family was my sister, but she never talked about what she did in the Army. So I didn't know anything about it, but I talked myself out of fuels because I was like, man, I don't want to smell like gasoline all day and be breathing in the fumes. And then I was like imagining myself getting sucked into a jet engine. So
that's a fair fear.
Exactly. It's happened. I saw it on the internet.
Yeah.
When I was 20.
Navy so planes. Like, but yeah.
I was like, no, I don't want to do that. And he was like, well, the other option, man, is you could be a cop. You could be kicking doors in. You could be this like fucking, Captain America,
right?
I was all in my head. I was like, cool, I'm gonna do that. And then you know how it goes, right?
Yeah.
I get into basic training, and it's the 320. I don't remember. There's a separate basic squadron that they pre-prep the special forces guys to go into. Something it's called like their motto is like a rock or something.
Oh,
I can't remember the squadron, 320th. I don't know. But I got into that little sex squadron for basic. And, you know, they're trying to have us do like lots of pull ups and stuff because most of the people that are in my basic are all going to special forces. And it was just a shock, man. Like, it was different. Like, the instructor was throwing chairs past my head, books and stuff near my head. Like, it was how it should be, in my opinion. You know, they basically mentally like mind fucked me.
Stress inoculation.
Yes, that's the professional term for it.
Yeah.
And I was singled out from day one of my military experience.
So you're old.
At 20? Come on. I felt like I was a kid.
Yeah, but when I went in basic, I was 23, and it was all 18-year-olds that just got out of high school. I hit the window right when they graduated.
Did they target you and like?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, dude. Like, I was just picked on, man. From like day one, I got picked on. It made me stronger at the end. It really did. But, you know, I was always trying to make an example. And then, you know, the drill instructor was always trying to break me down. And I would smile in his face. And I would get smoked in front of everybody while everybody watched me. Like, you know, and then eventually I don't really think I got broken. I think I just got made tougher.
Yeah.
You know, like I just got made a lot tougher. And then I went into security forces training and I was like, this is the gayest stuff I've ever seen. I hate everything. Like what, like this is not Captain America, you know, but I went through it and I did it. And, you know, I had these pre-injuries and I was nursing them, you know, through the training so that I was just, my fear was getting washed back and being stuck in hell.
Yeah.
So, you know, fast forward and made it through security forces and, you know, got picked on in security forces by instructors, landed my first base, which was Germany, like right off the rip. They sent me to the best place, which was awesome.
Lucky fucker.
Yeah. So, but it was even cooler because I didn't go to Ramstein, which is the big base. You know, I got sent to Volgaway, which is a satellite base that supplements Ramstein. The special thing about Volgaway, the 569th Police Force, is that they had a jurisdiction the size of Rhode Island extending all the way out to France. So when that individual in 2011 got shot at the Frankfurt airport, Volgaway was responding to that incident. And that was like right like a couple months or something before I got to the base. So like, dude, terrorists were killing airmen or, you know, U.S. service members in Germany in a terrorist attack, right? I don't know if you know about that, but he walked up on the airman walked up to him and was like, hey, man, do you have a cigarette that I could bum? And I think the guy gave him a cigarette. Then he smoked, you know, went back onto the bus with all the other people. And then the guy ended up going onto the bus and shooting it up that he bummed the cigarette from. So that had just happened. We're all freaked out. You know, I'm coming from tech school, going to Germany, thinking I'm going to get shot and stuff. Like, I was just afraid, man, because, you know, the way that they got your mind paranoid. But the cool thing about Volgaway, like I said, was the jurisdiction of my mission. Like, normally as security forces, you just do stuff that's on base and stuff like that. But we were responding off base to bars, to the downtown strip where everybody's drinking, and we work hand in hand with Polizei. It was just an intense, man, getting into fist fights, tasing people, stabbings. There was murders, responding to, you know, accidents on the Autobahn, people getting decapitated. Like, I saw some heinous shit.
Yeah.
At the 569th, man, in that time period. And then I also had some serious, like some fun, you know, lots of adrenaline dumps and getting into fights and tasing drunk people and stuff and getting punched in the face. Like, it was wild. And I talk about it like that kind of statistically, but like when you're 20 and you're just living life like that, it was exciting, you know?
Right. And you were on the verge of homelessness.
Next thing you know, and that's what I'm going to. So it was a wild thing. And then I went through I'm going to fast forward and go through my military. So I then became an armorer. So, you know, I started making money. God. When I became an armorer, that's when I became an entrepreneur.
Yeah, buddy.
Dude.
Who wants to get through this line real quick?
Yeah.
So explain the process so people understand what you're talking about when they.
All right.
Because regular cops, we get to take our weapons home.
Yeah.
You know,
so in the military, you don't get to take your weapons home because even though you're trusted with multi-million dollar assets, you're not trusted with your guns, right? When rightly so, kids shouldn't have the guns in their rooms because they're probably drinking and chemically unstable at that point, probably. But you turn your guns into an armory, and the armorer's job is to count for all the weapons, count all your ammunition, make sure that, you know, you didn't lose any rounds out of your magazine. and make sure your weapon gets turned in at the end of your shift. And it's the responsibility of every officer to basically keep their weapons clean and functioning, you know, order. So I would, when they go to turn their M4 into me, you know, I would turn to the side, look inside of it and see if it's dirty. And if I just didn't like your fucking face, and it didn't matter if you're a captain,
yeah,
if you're, you know, like, I would say your weapon's dirty, go clean it. And I don't even have to be respectful. Like, I just talk to people like that. Like, your weapon's dirty, you need to clean it. And they're like, I don't have time for that, I've got a meeting. I was like, well, if you want me to do it, I can do it, but I need, like, I don't know, $20 and I'll knock it out for you. Oh yeah, here's $20. And then 9 times out of 10, we would, it sounds so shitty, we wouldn't even clean them.
Because so they were cleaning up. You're hustling, yeah, motherfuckers.
Yeah. I mean, it was an armorer thing, man. They just did, yeah, it. And like, I made like hundreds and hundreds of dollars off of people's weapons, you know, and I did clean them most of the time, but
yeah,
sometimes I just forgot or didn't get to it, or I was doing something
else. Young kid stuff.
Yeah. Young kid stuff. So yeah, that's when I became an entrepreneur, realizing like, man, I'm making more money in the armory than I'm making from the military. Like, pretty damn close.
Yeah.
So damn. Yeah, it was crazy. It's like, am I going to go to jail for this? Like, is someone going to rat me out? But no, I mean, the officers, it was a practice. Like, they don't have time. They pay for a service and I do it. And they're happy to give me $20 so that they can go home to their families and they don't have to clean. Right. Bottom line is it has to get done by somebody, and it's getting done. So the whole process worked out.
Yeah.
I put
a fiver right inside the, mm-hmm, in the, where the flap held the thing. What's that thing called?
Your dust cover.
Dust cover. Yes. I couldn't think of the name. I'd put it in the dust cover and snap it down. And then he'd go online and be like, man, Levine, your weapon's always clean. I'm like, I know.
You figured out a way to circumvent, yep, my process. You knew it wasn't dirty. So you'd be like, argue with me probably then if I did say it was dirty.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cause it really is. You're paying for a service. You're like, yeah, all right, dude, like, just let's go. I want to get out of here. Cause for us, it was a little different. We're out in the missile field for 5 days at a time. You just want to get home. Like, it's been long enough. And trust me, that weapon was clean like 3 different times in the field. Cause there's nothing else to do.
Jeez. Yeah. I was always thankful that I never got sent to do those nuke missions and be at a nuke base, because I felt like it was probably like living like Groundhog's Day.
Yeah.
Over and over and over, repeating the same fucking thing and banging your head on a wall.
Now, as a canine guy, you might have loved it because them guys trained, yeah, all the time.
Yeah. But so I wasn't canine at the point of, you know, I was an armorer, a normal security forces guy. And then I got tasked for flyaway missions pretty much on call. And there was a shortage of Phoenix Ravens at the time period that I was doing that. So Phoenix Raven, there's only so many of them in security forces, and each of them have a assigned number. And then the guys that are ahead of them that are a little cooler is called Dagger. And Dagger do, you know, the setup of the guarding of the planes with special forces and, you know, high threat areas. And then Phoenix Ravens can also kind of do those. It just depends on the manning and the shortage or whatever, but the Daggers are probably...
So basically, a security forces Dagger and a security forces Raven are, yeah, they're still in the same umbrella. They just get higher elevated training and more responsibility.
And more dangerous missions, potentially. Right. So we had a shortage of all of it. And then what they were doing is taking regular security forces members, giving them a 2 or 4 weeks, I don't remember, course for guarding these aircrafts. And then they were just sending us off to all over places in like rural Africa. And man, we had some sketch situations and places, and like, they taught us the whole verbal judo and talking people down, you know, like de-escalation of force. And then as a last resort, you know, we had our M4s and full battle kits and everything on the bird in case we needed to defend the aircraft.
So what was the training like? So you're a regular security forces guy. You're coming, yeah, from the armory where they teach you.
It was a heavy,
Yeah, they teach everything about weapons, right? In the armory.
So what was the question?
I'm just trying to get people to understand like the type of training you went through to be an armorer, and then the training to switch.
Yeah. So, I mean, it wasn't as nice as that sounds. Like literally, hey, you want to be an armorer? Yeah, I want to be an armorer. And I had to like send up packages and get recommended to be, you know, proven trustworthy to account for, I don't know. I guess they were saying there was like $50 million of weapons and assets in that room. And then I'm 100% responsible for accounting of every bullet, everything. I have to count. So like, you need to have a brain on you to be able to do this. And you need to have attention to detail. Cause if something goes missing and let's say, a PEC 15, which is infrared laser device that we have on our weapons, goes missing, but I don't recognize that when I'm counting everything that's missing, like it's on me. I'm getting paperwork. I could get an article. I get investigated, you know. So it was a heavily responsible. Basically, the training was on everything in security forces. In my experience, was always on the job training, you know, for me. And then I had to work with shadow another armorer, and he had to teach me how to count, basically.
Yeah.
Like, the proper procedure accounting. But when I got tasked for flyaways, they just ripped me out of the armory trying to look for, you know, who's responsible. Well, the armorer is responsible because he is on his shit all the time and he's always accounting for things and he's been good, right? So they pulled me thinking, you know, well, this guy could be trusted. So they send me to flyaway security team and I go into training for that. And the training for the flyaway security team, like I said, they had a shortage of Ravens. So they were just taking regular security forces members and they were going to throw them on any missions that they needed to guard airplanes on.
So you're getting OJT, baby.
Yeah, dude. So they sent me through a short little course, which was basically like super heavy combatives. Like we had to fight multiple red men and they basically just, hey, like beat the shit out of you. And, you know, we had to do ASP stuff and it was all hand-to-hand combat. Because that's what they want. They don't want us going on the weapon, pulling guns in a foreign country and creating an international incident. So talk it down first, fight it out with your hands if you have to, and then as a lethal force, deadly force, right? That's how it works. So I went through that course, and then I went on these crazy missions. And after I did the six-month like deployment where I was flying all over Africa, I went to like almost every country in Africa. So I've seen the worst of poverty and it's just, you know, the craziest places. Then I went back into the armory and then they started pulling me out of the armory with no notice next day deployment missions. And that was when I was like, it was the coolest thing I ever did because like, I don't know, I just got addicted to it. Like them calling my cell phone in the middle of the night saying, pack your shit, you're leaving in 12 hours. That was
That's the movie shit right there.
100%, dude. And it was the coolest thing ever. So we got sent to some different locations during the storming of the embassies, during the Benghazi time period. There's some things we can't, you know, I shouldn't talk about. But we basically were on call in case some other embassies were going to be overran so that, you know, we could drop off some very special individuals to go take care of that. And then my responsibility is to guard the airplane at the safe zone, wherever that may be, for those special individuals to go do their job, which is still scary because, like, even though they parked the plane far enough away, it's still close enough that you're a sitting duck thinking, when are you going to get overran? Who's, you know, and you're constantly paranoid about, are they going to attack from this way? Are they going to attack for this way? Am I going to get circled? And I think some of that mindset for being put in those situations has led to some of my issues with like PTSD and being paranoid because I had to become a different like paranoid person to do those type of missions, you know,
hypervigilance,
hypervigilant stuff. And it's I still have it to this day. And I think it's not a curse. It's a blessing because like, I'm not going to be a target if I think like that, you know, what do you think?
Yeah. It's, I've talked to people about this before, as far as the PTSD of hypervigilance. It's an accumulative thing. It's not like, oh my God, I'll be hypervigilant this one time. It's here's your training. Here's what we're beating into your head all the time. Like, you don't know where the enemy's coming from.
Yeah.
And it's not just you thinking that, it's them telling you, like, this is what you need to, you had to have a head on a swivel. You need to be checking your six. You need to do all this shit. And then on top of that, don't let anything happen to this fucking plane. Don't let anything happen to your brothers out there.
Yeah.
And that's a heavy burden.
Yeah.
And then you start thinking that way all the time. And I just had this discussion with my wife the other day. We went out to eat with a newer officer. He's a younger guy. And you know, cops and military guys, you know, they have that typical thing. You go out to a restaurant, you make sure your back's to the wall so you can see the doors, see who's coming in and all that stuff. Well, you could see the hypervigilance in him. He's just constantly, we're talking and he's looking, and where guys like you and I who have adapted to that, and we look comfortable, we look calm, cool, collected. But all that same stuff's processing. We're still looking. We're still seeing that stuff. We just don't present it because we've figured out a way to blend in with normal society with that same mindset.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think, yeah, you're definitely correct on that. It's accumulative over a period of time of just dealing with it. And you become, like you said, you become better over a period of time of dealing with those feelings and stuff. And they never go away. And I'm glad they never go away, because there's so many people out there, man, that are just fucking oblivious to things.
Yeah, you know, like face buried in their phone.
And, yeah, like,
yeah.
You know, I was watching another podcast, and they were talking about basically there were criminals that were interviewed, and they were seeing, like, what type of people would you target the most? You know, and they had like a list of characteristics that people actually look for. And it was pretty wild stuff. It was like, you know, people's posture, the way you carry yourself. If you don't make eye contact with other individuals around you.
Yeah.
Because you're not confident in, like, just making eye contact with people and looking at them in the eyes, they will become aware that you're watching them. So therefore, they don't want to attack you, right? The way you walk and carry yourself, you know. And I think us in the military, we, and especially in the security forces capacity, we had to walk up on anybody and try to and be a what's the word I'm looking for, a command presence, right? That's what we said, yeah. You know, your command presence. And it didn't matter if, like, especially in Germany, you know. Let's say there's a couple of drunken special forces guys. I have to walk up to them and potentially, like, well, we're going to fight then, you know, I'm going to,
yeah,
but there's going to be six of me against two of you, you know? Yeah, so
yeah, we always have people around the corner. Yeah.
Yeah. For good reason. But yeah. The thing is that what I'm saying is that transferred over to command presence and, like, being aware and stuff. So it's good. But I got a little sidetracked on the story. So after flyaway security, I ended up putting in a package to try to become canine. And it was during a transition of PCSing out of Germany. And I got sent to Andrews Air Force Base. So Andrews Air Force Base is in Maryland, which is the presidential base. So there's two separate units there. One of them is the regular security forces. And then there's another unit that does all of the presidential support, and you have to have a top secret security clearance and get approved for a top secret. And then
whose
you have to
ass get, did you kiss to get all these badass bases?
Dude, it was just luck, man. So it was like, I was like the luckiest guy in the Air Force, it felt like, but I was also constantly singled out and targeted by people that hated me than higher command and stuff too. And they just didn't like my attitude, the way I spoke, the way I had confidence and carried myself.
Yeah.
But I got sent to Andrews. I got qualified for a top secret. And then I got qualified for a special Air Force clearance called a Yankee White, which means that allows you to be approved to carry your weapon in the presence of the president.
Oh.
Because you're not everybody's trusted with a gun around the president. So we work details with Secret Service. And we got to carry a gun. But what's crazy is Secret Service is always looking at us because we're a potential. There's always a potential for an insider threat, right?
Yeah.
So we would be sitting out in our posts around the president and Air Force One, and we would look up and you would see a special forces agent in the sniper tower aiming his gun at us because he's just watching us through the scope.
Yeah.
And I'm like, balances. I ain't touching my M4, bro. Like, I keep my hands on the dash. Don't shoot me.
Yeah.
So that's how crazy it was, is, you know, that's how there's checks and balances, you know?
Yeah.
But, then I got accepted as canine, went to canine school, and that's where my life kind of changed. And I fell in love with the dog stuff. Cause before that canine school, I wasn't crazy about dogs growing up. My father had a bunch, and I kind of saw them as a nuisance because he never had them trained. And, you know, I like dogs, but I wasn't crazy about them. So I went to canine school, and that's when I became crazy about them, because we learned about war dogs and like the history of all the dogs that went through Vietnam and World War II and the program and the sacrifices that the dogs helped, you know, make, and then going through it and like building bonds with dogs with when you're training, and like realizing that your training and your bond with this dog will prevent you from getting blown up and turned into red mist. Like, right. Dude, that's heavy. You know what I mean? This animal and the work ethic you put in with this animal will save you from getting blown up by an IED, or you're still going to get blown up by an IED no matter how good you are, because it's just shit happens. You know what I mean? But at least you could be in the forefront of saving a bunch of people, you know, locating that IED, and you save a bunch of other kids, man, you know, they're, you know, other soldiers and airmen or whatever. So that just touched my heart really, really close, man, to see the bonds and like understanding, you know, being an explosive canine handler, just really, to me, is like a selfless job. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I already went into it. Like, you're giving up your life to save other people. And that's from the start what I wanted. I never felt fulfilled in security forces because it wasn't enough. Like, I needed some sort of other detail. I wish I could have been special forces, you know, worked as a team, like, you know, the canine changed it for me because it was different. And then I became, you know, presidential canine. So then I got to go on like Gucci missions, which is like, you know, let's say the Secretary of State is going to Ireland for a heritage trip. Well, we would get tasked to go do that with Secret Service, and we would be sweeping the streets and everything and checking baggage, and I would get to stay in 5-star resorts and stuff, and with my dog
up on the bed. Come on, yep, buddy. Yep.
In a 5-star, you know, place. It was it was cool. And I got to go all over the world. I got to meet other people. I felt fulfilled. I was doing presidential missions. And then
eventually, you meet the president?
Yeah, I've met Obama and I've met Trump, because I served under both administrations, you know, just to say hi to them. We basically had, I don't even know if I should talk about Hillary Clinton, dude.
Oh, hey, famous person, man.
I don't want to disappear off the face of the earth. We're talking about it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Get Jeffreyed.
Yep. So get into a little bit, like, because there's going to be people who will be like, all right, you went into military canine training. Like, what's day one like? How do you get a dog? How does that whole relationship start to build?
Yeah.
What's the deal?
They're heavy on driving home that sacrificial picture of the dogs and what they did throughout the different wars. And they don't let you have a dog right off the bat. So that you've got to prove that you're worthy of operating one of these animals. So people always say, well, the military treats dogs like equipment. you know, they stay in the kennel buildings, this, that, but they still, through the school, they teach you that this creature is almost, is more important than you are. So they start you off with a stuffed animal or an ammo can, excuse me, an ammo can that you have to pretend is your live dog. And what they have you do is they have you master a couple of core skill-based things that you need to learn, which is one of them is like mastering your different voices. You have a praise voice, a command voice, and a correction voice. So we would be outside in San Antonio in the sun, and I went through in the middle of summer with our ammo can in the sun, and I'm practicing my praise voice on an inanimate object going, "Who's a good boy? Good boy. You know? Yeah. And the whole point was that you got to drop your ego and you got to master this skill, because like giving that praise voice to the dog matters. It's a difference in paying a dog with a $20 bill or a $100 bill. You need to be able to inflect your voice, because the animals understand voice inflection, not words. They don't speak English. But when you go, "Who's a good boy?" the dog's ears perk up and they know it's a happy sound, right? And when you do your correction and you go, "No," in a deeper voice, the dog's ears go down and they you know, retreat. They understand voice inflection. And because it relates and correlates to what they do to each other in communication as well. Growling, yipping, you know, different noises. So they wanted you to master that on an inanimate object, drop your ego. And some people are like, I can't fucking do that voice. Well, then you don't need to be canine, because your ego sucks. So they're trying to phase people out too. You know, there is an attrition rate, or whatever the word is, to kick people out of that shouldn't be canine. Because they also don't want people that are going to abuse animals in canine either, right?
Yeah.
So they're looking, they're heavily watched to see how, like, who they can kick out of the program. So they start you off with that, like I said, an inanimate object, and then they end up getting you on your dog. And in the beginning, everything is about care of that animal, grooming it, taking care of it, checking it out for, you know, doing health and welfare checks, looking under the armpit, you know, surface of the dog, seeing if there's any masses or anything. Like, you need to become a servant to this animal to take care of it. And then they start getting you into the training and education and everything like that. So between the painting the picture of the sacrifice of the animals and the team, and then talking to you about like explosive detection handling and like really being hard on you, you know, like you walk into a room and turn a light on, you're fucking dead, dude. You're looking for bombs. Why'd you go turn that light switch on? Right. What if the bomb was wired to that light switch, you idiot? You know, and that's how we talk to each other. You're like, "Oh my God, that's true. All right, you're dead. Like, go sit out in the field and think about how stupid you are, because you're dead and you killed everybody else too." So you get, it goes in your head, and you really start thinking about your actions. And then you start thinking about, well, you know, like, man, I need to do better with this, and I need to be more aware and let my, you know, put my dog in the right places. Because the whole thing of canine is being a team. You know, you can have there's amazing dogs out there that make crappy handlers look good. But when both parts of the team are good, which I guess I sound a little jaded, but like it rarely is. A lot of times it's either one side or the other is good. You know, it's like the dog side is doing all the work and the handler is just, he's worthless. He's just getting pulled around. But then sometimes there's good teams where you have the foresight to be able to look at the space that you're in and be able to put your dog in the positions that he can do, or you let your dog search the room and then you see all the spots that he missed, and then you go and present the missed spots to get the best opportunity to find whatever you're looking for, right? So you start to be able to like articulate and spatially think in three dimensions, you know, of depth, height, width. Is there breeze? Is there drafts? Where's the wind sucking? What's the wind direction? So canine gets into like, if you're truly a master at your craft, you're thinking in all of these dimensions while operating an animal, paying attention to his breath pattern, the way his fur changes, the way the tail starts to change, that's what's called a change of behavior or just noticeable difference. And that's where you start to become, you know, I never became a master of my craft even when I was in the Air Force. It took years, even afterwards, still working and shadowing some of the best people, to consider myself to be amongst the ranks of the best. And I'm still like not, you know, I'm still, I got to be humble. Like,
yeah,
there's always somebody out there that's better than you. And I always go into things looking to try to learn from others and, you know, digest their material so that I have more tools, you know, to use. And I think that's what's helped me position myself to be more respected. So I always go off on tangents, man, on
it's fine.
Questions you ask, but
it's good. I mean, you're giving people an insight of what it's like to start training a dog and how you started out in the military as a canine trainer or handler, and then it evolves. So
So I was just a handler, and man, I hate to say it, but the atmosphere of canine is very ego driven. Who's the best? Who's the smartest? Who's got the best dog? Who works the fucking hardest? You know, that's the type of personality. It's very alpha, very A personality. A lot of these guys too, generally don't like other people. That's why they're with dogs, because they don't like human beings. So it can be a very ugly competitive space, but, I just, you know, if you don't pay attention to any of that bullshit, you just focus on your own grass, you'll be good. I realized early too in canine that if you learn your the regs, or you know, you're a subject matter expert in study, and you can articulate and explain things in detail around people, nobody can ever discredit you. You just got to be an expert, you know?
Yeah.
But, I'm trying to think what else that I could give value to about canine. Just a lot of people need to know that it's not a fun space to be in. Like, a lot of times you're not ever supported for your victories. Your fellow peers are pretty much, for the most part of my experience, not supportive, but they're jealous. They want to be the ones that are finding X things and getting recognized, you know? And I don't want to push people away from it, but they need to know what they're getting into, you know?
Yeah.
It's a highly competitive space. And if you got thin skin, you're going to get destroyed by it. And it's like, in order to do it, you truly need to love this craft. You need to be obsessed with it, because it'll burn you out faster than anything I've ever done before in my life.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if you've seen it with the other canine guys, like they walk around like they're king shits on earth.
Well, I think part of that goes into, they've got access to everything and the comforts of everything, because the dog can't be overheated, so he's going to have AC. And you know, all the rest of the security forces are put in the shit. They're put in the worst spots that nobody else wants to be in for.
You defense. Got AC, you got air conditioning.
Yeah. But as a canine, you got AC, you got a TV, you got, you know, the dog needs it. I got to be near food. The dog needs it, you know, all this stuff. And nobody's going to say anything, because nobody else is trained in what you do.
Yep. And then that's another key point that I enjoyed, is higher ranking individuals, let's say a flight chief of another of the other cops, would try to tell me how to do something. Normally you got to be respectful. Yes, sir. I'll do that. Right.
Yeah.
Excuse me. I would basically be like, sir, you don't know what you're talking about. I'm a subject matter expert. I'm the one that went through the school. These are my procedures under operation, blah, 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 under, you know, the regs. I'm allowed to operate within 50 feet of this and this is, so please respectfully allow me to do my job the way I need to do it, sir.
Yeah.
And then that's why people hated me too, because that's how I would talk to, a, you know, I think I talked to a major that way one time.
Yeah.
And then he went back and he's like, well, he was doing his job and he's one of the best at it. So
yeah,
he's like, but they would call me back in the office and be like, you know, Sergeant McNamara, you've got to really work on your, what's the word? The way that you present yourself, you know, you don't have to come at everybody like they're attacking you or something, you know?
Right. Right. Yeah. Be a little more people friendly.
Yeah. I wasn't, but that's how a lot of us are. And I think that's what makes, makes us do the job, is those are the type of individuals that gravitate towards that position.
Yeah. It's a cultural norm within that career field.
Yeah. You're not going to tell him what to do and how to do his job in any way. Yeah.
Right.
And then even if you are canine and you try to tell somebody else, it's just, it's two jugheads arguing and no one's ever going to go anywhere.
Right.
So I was just a handler in the Air Force, but I was very observant and quiet. I watched people that I could realize that were good, and I just started absorbing everything I could. I took the Air Force regulations, you know, AFMAN and the AFIs, which are Air Force instructions of how to do different things in it. And like a crazy person, I just read them. Be like, what? You read them? Like, yeah, I read everything. I read it thoroughly front to back. I memorized things. I read it like a Bible.
Yeah.
So when I got addressed for something, I was like a robot that could spit out regulations in the thing in my career field. But that also helped me understand how to do things, right? So I started to learn more, and I studied and studied and studied. And then as I got out, I can canine book even to this day that I can find. If it's a hunting dog book, I read it. If it's another book about explosive detection, I read it. I've made friends with people at Lackland that are much higher up than me, you know, people that have studied under what's called, you know, there's a blue patch and red patches. There's only so many red patches that are at Lackland that are master dog trainers, you know? And I absorb information from human beings. Like, everything that's in your brain, I'm going to pull it out, you know? And that's how I've became. So in a lot of ways, as a trainer, I have been self-educated and self-taught with a baseline of Lackland Air Force Base handler course. So what's crazy is that contract that I won, the training program that I wrote for the Palauans was Lackland's Air Force Canine Handler School program. So are you tracking on that?
Yeah. Yeah. You didn't reinvent the wheel.
No, I took the military's program and trained them with a watered down version of it.
Yeah.
And it translated really well. The government loved it. It's like, oh, this, you know, we're paying to give them a program, and the program is based off of Lackland. It's a DOD standard. It translated perfect. This is beautiful, right?
Yeah.
Didn't reinvent the wheel. I just used what the military gave me and capitalized on it for private company profit.
Yeah. You know, just, I mean, that's a lot of things in life. It's not, I don't look at that as a bad thing. I look at that as, did you get what you wanted? Is it what you know, because you can't just yank some military canine handler out of his job to come do this. You got to have somebody that's trained in it. You separated from the military. You did your time, honored your contract, honorable discharge. And now you're taking the skills that the military gave you and applying them. I kind of did the same thing. I was trained to be a cop. I got out and went and became a cop. And it made training that much easier when I went through an academy and everything else.
But I mean, so, it is a little different because, like, I got a $2.5 million contract, and all I did was use the military's program to sell it back to them.
Yeah.
So, I mean, hey, it is what it is.
It is what it is.
You know,
smart move.
Yeah, I'm smart enough to figure that out.
Yeah. I mean, and it's great that, you know, as much as the military uses us, you know, we signed the dotted line. We accepted the fact that we're going to be used by them. But at the same time, you are a fool if you don't utilize and take advantage of all the training that they can give you that you think you may use when you get out, if you decide not to go career.
Yeah.
And yeah, I did that.
Yeah. I'm trying to think what shifted to make me get out. I think it was the politics and the way the military started changing. I just didn't want to be a part of it. I started getting tired of having to constantly argue and prove my point. And then when I was at my kennels in Andrews, Man, I had so many people withholding information from me, not letting me grow, not letting me take charge, not letting me lead things, not just being held back. And I was like, fuck this, man. Like, I want out.
That's why I got out of active.
It is. That might be, might be a common thing is just these people not allowing you to be you. You know? So I got out. Same.
Yeah, I was being told, you know, like, Levine, you're hot shit. You're doing this right. You're doing that. And I had moved around. I basically got every job I had applied for because I like to excel at what I do and I like to learn. So I was learning all this stuff. Well, I was working corrections at the time and worked around. That's where canine hung out, was in the corrections area. So I'm like, man, this canine stuff looks fun. Like, I would love to do what y'all do. I want to do that. So I was coming up on the end of my 4-year contract and I was like, I'll extend for 2 years if you can give me canine. You know, I still didn't intend to stay in the Air Force. I just knew that I could get the canine training and then use that to get out in the civilian world as a cop. And I get told I had basically been put in a tech sergeant position as a senior airman. Oh, wow. And they kept doing like a waiver, because there was a AFI waiver that they could do for 6 months until they get a person trained up to get in that position. Well, they get me spun up and I do so good at it that they're like, well, we'll just leave you here and we'll do another waiver, which I don't think was what they're allowed to do, but they did it anyway. And my separation was coming up. So I was like, hey, commander, you know, I was like, I want to extend. I want to stay in and do canine. It's like, yeah, I think we can do that. Well, my paperwork sitting on his desk, the window's coming up. Finally, I get up there. I got to know what's going on. Like, it's like, well, this is what we're going to do. We're going to leave you in that spot for one more year because it's, you know, like a 4-month academy or whatever to get trained up to do that spot. We'll get somebody spun up and then we'll send you to canine afterwards. You know, as well as I do, you can't go do canine for a year. You have to honor 2 years. So this is going to make me stay in for 4. And I was like, I don't want to. I already wanted to get my degree. I knew exactly what I wanted to do. And I have done everything you've asked. I've excelled, and you're going to hold me back to fit your numbers, to make your needs easier while you're here.
You would have loved it though.
I probably would have loved it. Yeah. No doubt. But I got in, I knew I'm a goal oriented person. So I got in to finish, to get a degree and get out and go be a cop somewhere, whether it was a 3-letter agency or, you know, city police somewhere, whatever it is. And I got my degrees. I got that while I was in. And here I was. I was like, you know what? I hadn't considered the canine thing, but that would still help me on the outside. So let me try to do that. And they didn't want to let me do that. So I said, fuck this. I'm like, you're going to exactly what you're saying. They were holding me back.
Yep.
They weren't allowing me to do what I've earned. I'd earned it, in my opinion. So I was like, I'm thanks, but no thanks. I'm out. You dragged your feet. Now it's too late. I had already gotten a job 4 months before I was separating.
Yeah. My separation story is pretty funny. I ended up reaching out to some private security companies and seeing if I could get a letter of like pre-employment. And then somebody sent one to me, but it didn't have the right info and it was going back and forth. So I kind of just edited it and then sent and routed it up to my commander saying that I already had a job, and I basically didn't. And then I got allowed to be separated 6 months early.
Oh shit.
So I played the system a little bit on that, but I knew, I was like, I'm out, I'm leaving. I don't care what I got to do. The only thing, the downfall of that is they're trying to ensure that people really do have jobs. So when you get out, you don't land on your face and become homeless.
Yeah.
You know, that's what they were trying to prevent. And I was like, listen, I here's a letter. I got a job. I knew at that time period, I'm starting a business and I'm going to go work for myself. But if I tried to early separate with, I'm going to go work for myself, no way, you're not going to be allowed. So I just did what I needed to do to get out. And then I got, and they separated me 6 months early. Cool. He's got a 6-figure job lined up. And then I went and I was, got out and I was like, nah, I start my company. So I started my company and I was training dogs, doing boarding trains for like the public. And I was living, so I bought a house in Maryland when I was stationed there. It was a split level house and I rented out the top of the house. And I basically lived in the basement of my own house. Okay. Thinking about it now, I should have taken the top floor instead of and rented out the bottom. But being a care, like a giving person, I gave him the top, and I just was like, you know what? I'll live down here. It's, you know, it's got its own entry and it's fine, which was a terrible decision because I would hear his footsteps. It drove me crazy. Like,
yeah.
I'm a hermit in a basement of my own freaking house. It's just a terrible decision.
Yeah.
But I was boarding, and it was less than 1,000 square feet of what I was living in too. But I was started my business there, and I boarded maybe one or two dogs at a time. And then at the most, I think I took 5 in there, which was insane. I had them in the crates pretty much next to my bed. And that's where I started, dude. I started from the bottom, and I separated from the Air Force with $57 in my bank account. Jeez, I had no savings, $57 in my bank account, and I'm started a business with nothing, bootstrap $0. I got a kennel, got a dog, got my first client. It was $2,500 to train that dog.
Score.
Train the dog up, and I realized $2,500. What if I did 10 dogs in a month? Well, I can't fit 10 dogs in here, you know? And then I was just like racking my brain. So I got to the point where I'd take on about 5 or 6, and it was like crazy. And it was super hard. And the dogs, you know, sometimes would poop in the kennels, and I'm wake up in the middle of the night and they're barking. It was just miserable. But the first month of my business, I made $10,000 in a month. I never made that in the Air Force.
Right.
You know? And then Maryland winter hit. 0 clients. Nobody was sending their dogs off to get trained. I went broke. I went into debt. I got so broke that I couldn't afford oil. So the houses up there use like an oil for their heaters. And that's how you heat your house, is with this furnace. I couldn't afford oil to have the tank filled for the winter. I froze in the basement. I thought it was so bad that I was going to die in the basement. That's how bad it got and how broke I was. And I was behind on my mortgage. And I was like, yep, well, this is what I get for early separating. I'm going to fucking become homeless.
Yeah.
Ended up making it through the winter, and then summer hit and I started making money, boarding more dogs, doing blah, blah, blah. That's also when I took a break from my own business, because it was just, you know, a lot of work. And I did some contract work, as I took a job I'd never even done before. It was installing security systems in the embassies. So like these maglock doors and all of this camera equipment.
How are you finding these dogs to train? And
I was advertising on Facebook pages. I was posting, and that's around the time period that you and I met through social media, was when I was living in that basement.
Yeah, we had mutual Air Force friends.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that's when you started going. I mean, I was battling depression of just separating the Air Force. I was trying to make ends meet. Like my mind was all over the place, man. It was bad. And then I took a gig in Africa installing security systems I did it for a year. And I went to Africa. I got malaria, almost died.
And then, shit.
Yeah, I got malaria, almost died. And then I came back. I made, I was making about, I don't know, close to 15 G's a month on that contract job in Africa. So I came back balling,
nice.
put it into my company, bought all the equipment, gear, everything I needed, and kept going. Still was battling depression, was drinking, was going out all the time, making terrible decisions. I was trying to figure out how to grow my company out of this basement so I could stop. I could get out of there, you know?
Yeah.
I had a little bit of money, maybe 2 or 3 grand in the bank account at all times. I'm okay. You know, I'm doing all right, but I'm not where I want to be. So I started going to different networking events and trying to meet people. And that's where it clicked in my head. Well, not there. Later on, it clicked in my head that networking is the most important skill that you need to master, is who you know, not what you know, but who you know. I was always a what you could know, Mr. Know-it-all, try to, you know, whatever. But nobody likes that guy because he's pompous and he thinks he knows everything, right?
Right.
Later on, it clicked. You need to know people and you need to help people. and you need to, you know, care about other people, and that's what will make you successful. So I went to an event and I met another veteran, and he was opening a brewery, which was awesome. So I went to his grand opening and I met him, and another veteran introduced me to him because he was my friend, you know. He goes, hey, meet this guy. So I met him, and basically at his event, I told you I had a drinking problem at that point. I went to the brewery grand opening and got sloshed, like just drank way too much, man. And
yeah,
kind of a bad, like I was ashamed of my image that I put, but I guess it really wasn't that bad, but I still got drunk at it. And just making bad decisions, man. And I met the guy. I introduced myself. I was trying to be as confident as I could. You know, he was like, who are you or whatever? And I was like, oh, you know, I'm Shane McNamara. I own Bellum Canine. I train the world's best police dogs. I literally said that. I train the world's best police dogs, drug dogs, bomb dogs. You name it, I'm the guy for it. And he was like, wow, you know, I guess he really felt my confidence when I said that. And it was probably like 3 or 4 beers in. So I was super confident. You know, so
it's all subjective, whatever. So,
and then it was like, who am I talking to? I'm talking to a guy that owns a brewery, right?
Yeah. No,
the guy was in charge of pretty much the Department of the Navy's civilian contract acquisitions.
Oh.
But I had no idea. And, you know, he doesn't introduce himself like that. And that's why I was. So there was another night where, you know, let's say 2 months goes by after that event, and I'm out partying and spending my money, little bit that I had, drinking at bars, trying to pick up girls, you know, during that time period of my life. And I wake up the next morning just so hungover and like don't know where I am. The world's spinning. My phone's ringing. I answer it. Hello, this is Shane Bellum Canine at that time. And then, you know, he introduced himself. I'm not going to put names on here. He goes, well, I'm blah, blah, blah. I met you at the grand opening of my company, but that's not all I do. I'm a blah, blah, blah for the U.S. government. And we're trying to do some preemptive research on a contract that came across our desk for canine on this island. Would you be interested in, you know, helping us understand what could be needed on it? And find some people that could help, you know, maybe be introduced to do it. You know, they would of course have to compete for it, and you know, there's a process where you have to fairly win it. And I was like, sure, yeah, that's exactly what my company does. And I was like, you know, I was training people's pets, so it's like fake it till you make it. You know, be confident. Yeah. And it's the story of a movie, like almost like War Dogs, you know. And I just sold it. I said, yeah, I'll help you with it. So started working with their office and calculating all the costs and everything that needed. And, you know, a program needs equipment. It needs gear. It needs food. It needs a veterinarian support. It needs a program. This is the type of program that they should be given. This is the course duration. Dude, it was involved. And it's realistically probably going to cost. I mean, look at this. This is like $2.5 million. Oh, you know, $2.5 million. He's like, oh, great. Perfect. Thank you for getting that for us. And then he's like, would you have any capability to do it, to do the contract? And I was like, yeah, that's exactly what my company does. Well, that's what I wanted my company to do.
Yeah.
But that's what, you know, you can't say that's what I want my company to do. I say that's what my company does. You know, if you believe it and you speak it, you will do it, right? Or you give it your best shot. I mean, you're just going to send it, bro.
Yeah. See if it works.
I told him that. And then he's like, cool. Well, I'll put you in contact with these big companies because we can't, you know, you can't go get the contract directly because you're not set up for that. But these large corporations are going to compete and bid on it. So introduce yourself to them. And if they like you, they'll use you. You know, I can't make anything happen for you, but if you go out and you give it your best hand, then you may end up getting this, you know? And I was like, shit, okay. So I'm going to meetings. I'm wearing suits. I'm introducing my company and myself with two executives of these major prime companies that do like hundreds of millions of dollars for the U.S. government in various contracts from aviation to you name it, you know, like basically let's say you had to go speak in front of Lockheed Martin to win a security contract for all their planes, and you got to tell them about your company and why your company can do it, right?
Right.
So that's what I did. And I'm like, I've never done any of this before. But, you know, there's things that I learned in the Air Force that are helping me. The way I keep my bearing, the way I make eye contact. Dude, even freaking Airman Leadership School, you know, to become a NCO, you know, my the speech, speaking in front of the class, not saying those things all clicked, dude, and it worked into that corporate environment.
Yeah. And
I sold my company, and then, like, I rewind a little bit. I ended up pulling some other people that were, you know, friends of mine. You know, Joel Congdon, he was my supervisor in the Air Force. I told him what I had going on. And it's like, dude, I need you to come in and pretend like you're my you're the VP of the company. Like, because I'm a one guy show, but I need, we need to look bigger. Otherwise, we're never going to get this contract. So he's like, okay, I'll come in. We'll do it. And we're literally like the movie War Dogs, bro.
Yeah.
Doing it in front of these people and putting on slideshows and showing what we can do and the ops and everything. And they're like, they bought off on it. And they're like, yeah, so if we end up winning this contract, we will definitely use your services on it. Nice. They ended up winning the contract. It took 2 years, but they won the contract. And then they called me up and said, hey, we won the contract. Are you ready to deliver on this? I'm like, yeah. So there was a point in time period in 2020 when we won it, we got to go. And they started wiring money to my bank account. There's a screenshot that I have. My bank account, my business bank account, Bellum Canine, had $1 million in it.
Damn.
That is an amazing feeling
to
look at your thing that you created and you, and let's say a year before that, a year and a half before that, you were shivering in a basement thinking you're going to die of hyperthermia, training people's dogs that are pooping and peeing everywhere, to now you have $1 million deposited into your bank account.
Right.
It's unreal. It's a movie, man. This isn't real life. And that happened. And then I can always jump to a negative side of that, or a funny side of that is you can blow through that $1 million in 3 months, man. Like nothing.
That's what I was going to ask. Like,
bro,
like you get that money, like, were you putting it into the business? How did that?
That money, that contract costed way more money than I ever imagined that I pre-accounted it to cost. So when they bid it on it and we awarded it and all that money and stuff, you know, like it was way more expensive at the end than I ever imagined. So yeah, I mean, all the money's going towards salaries. It's going to purchasing the dogs. It's going towards like shipping containers, vessels, like sending over, you know, gear and equipment. 100,000. I'd write a check for 100 G's in equipment to Ray Allen for bite suits, sleeves, choke chains, collars. 100 grand. You know, there was one day I sat back in the office and was talking to Jenny, and I was like, Jenny, I just spent $185,000 in the last 3 hours. She said, what? I said, I spent $183,000 and tomorrow I'm going to spend $250,000. I was writing checks for money that I've never even comprehended. I've never even seen. I'm operating at a level that's like, and you know what's crazy? I'm only 20. When I won the contract, I think I was 28.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't even 30.
Yeah.
And I'm dealing with $1 million in a business bank account of my own and managing it. We ended up getting almost close to $2.5 million came through the business in the 2 year period from that contract. So, you know, I walked away with a little penny of it that got me my house, my property here.
Yeah.
You know, so I won on it and I did come out on top. And it's positioned me to be where I am today. And I'm still constantly reinvesting everything I make now into what I'm building. But it's just crazy. And the lesson that I want to paint on this podcast is that you could be at rock bottom and like depressed, literally thinking about killing yourself because I was in a bad spot during that time period when you first met me. Didn't voice it all the time. You know, I actually voiced it in the opposite way, looking like I'm doing great, but I wasn't. Yeah. Shivering, not knowing how I'm going to make ends meet, miserable, to literally being a multi, like feeling like a multimillionaire, having this money in your business bank account, having whatever you want, doing on top of the world. And then it's just keep your head up and keep digging, man. Like, don't give up. Don't give up on any of it. You know, and I bet you felt that with your podcast in the beginnings, you know, I don't know. You tell me.
Yeah, it was, man, I had an idea and it was based on wanting to help people, you know, wanting to kind of bridge this gap. You know, police definitely aren't seen in the best light with social media these days and trying to figure out a new way to do things. And it, you know, you got TikTok cops shaking their ass, dancing. Okay, it's funny, you know. I'm glad it brings some people in. It's one way, but it's not my way. I wanted something of substance, and I wasn't sure how to do that. And my original idea was like using Facebook to help fight crime, which I think is a great tool. But that was like that's how the whole idea sparked. I'm like, we're not talking to the community, and we're not learning from each other. And I'm like, I think we could use Facebook as a crime fighting tool. That's kind of how the idea sparked. But eventually I came up with the podcast idea.
What do you mean by a crime fighting tool? How are you fighting crime? Okay.
So one way would be like, let's say we had a closed Facebook group that is your neighborhood. Okay. Mm-hmm. We'll keep it small. And I am the neighborhood officer and I would be on there during my shift, you know, making sure that I'm keeping up with everybody, kind of like a virtual town hall meeting that's always accessible. Yeah. And somebody's pulling car door handles, you know, on cars, and somebody could post, oh, I just got this guy walked through my driveway. And then me as the neighborhood officer, I could see that picture. I could get it out to the other.
Yeah. Groups. My neighborhood does this. Yeah.
So back in the day, this wasn't a thing.
Yeah, we do it through a group me thing on our phones, and we just have a group chat. But it only came together because a developer bought this piece of land behind all of our homes and is putting in 350 trailers, single-wide trailers, 350 of them, and all of them are going to be accessed on my private little tiny road. So we're going to have like 1,000 cars of traffic on this tiny road. But we all came together to try to stop this developer, but out of it, we've had some vehicle break-ins and stuff like that. So we were able to like share our footage and we communicate on things. Hey, who's doing this, this, and this? Or I saw this going down here. And it's awesome to be able to have that in a community. So
yeah. And
but ours formed naturally somehow.
Yeah. And that was just one aspect of an idea, like you said, that was developing. You knew you wanted to train dogs, but military contracts and shit like that, those are, well, things you don't consider, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh,
what's crazy is when I started my business plan and wrote, like, created my company, I wrote a business plan for a private security contracting canine company, but I was forced to pay the bills by training people's pets. So I started the company with the vision of government contracts, and then I literally manifested it and it came true.
Yeah.
Like it that's another thing. I don't know if you believe in that. Like, if you manifest 2 cops, 1 donut to be as big as Joe Rogan and you relentlessly pursue it, eventually eventually with enough mental power, it can come to fruition.
Yeah.
I believe that thoroughly to a T, because I've done it over and over and over. I envisioned myself becoming canine and relentlessly pursued it and became it. I envisioned becoming, you know, having $1 million in the bank account, relentlessly pursuing it, and it happened.
Yeah.
Manifestation is 100% real, man.
Yeah.
Off topic.
I mean, I don't know if I would call it manifestationism. I told you I'm a goal oriented person. Like,
yeah,
when I set
your logic,
it's
logical.
Yeah. And I'm like, this is the steps I'm going to try to take to get where I need to get. And just like anything else, it may work, it may not, but something always presents itself that shows a solution. And I just take it instead of being like, I don't think that's going to work. I'm like, no, that, it's obvious that this is going to help you get there in some small facet. So even if it could be the fix, it could be just something that, you know, guides you a little bit more towards it.
I'm a little different than you. I see things kind of from like a tinfoil hat perspective a little more where like I believe in manifestation and energy and like,
yeah,
like if your mental power can come into something and create it, like, you know, I don't know. I watch all that crazy stuff. That's why I like Joe Rogan. Yeah. That's why I like all those other like podcasts about conspiracy theories and stuff. And
yeah. And it's not that I definitely would never tell anybody that they're wrong. I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe what you're thinking is the same way I'm thinking. We just have a different way of explaining it.
True.
Yeah. You know what I mean?
Our consciousness is different. The way that we're seeing things work.
Yeah. Yeah. And I look back at my life and on paper, I'm looking, I'm like, oh my God, maybe I manifested all this shit to happen.
I got a question for you. So do you like being an entrepreneur? Cause that's what you are with the podcast. That's an entrepreneur. It is like you have a business that gets sponsors and paid and you're a business owner. You may not like the word entrepreneur, but let's say, I'll phrase it as business owner. Do you like being a business owner more than being a cop?
No, I hate it.
What?
I hate it. I hate all of it.
Why?
I like this. This is what I like doing. I like connecting with
that's
people.
That's what I'm talking about. This. But
for me, like if I could have somebody else do everything else after we get off here and stop talking, that'd be great. It.
Like you hire a manager to run everything and you just do the talks, right?
That would be amazing. I would love it, but well, I'm not there.
You got to manifest it.
I'm trying. I am trying to do that. No, I do. I really enjoy this. I actually even enjoy the process of editing and, I didn't think I would, but I find it to be it's a reset for my brain.
Yeah.
Because I'm not thinking about cop stuff all the time.
And I think you get to thrive with some, like having some sort of form of creative expression.
Yes, exactly. My buddy, he's a photographer and he's like, you know what you do is art. I was like, I don't know if I buy that. And then he starts to explain.
Perspective.
He's like, you're creating this. Like, look what you've created. Look how it's grown since your first episode. And every time I start to doubt myself, I just go back to my very first episode where you can only hear me talk in your right ear and you can only hear him talk in your left ear. And it's just, I'm like, oh my fuck, man, I've come a long way.
When I give people a business advice and stuff, like everyone thinks that they need to have it figured out from the jump. You don't, dude. You just send it. I didn't have it figured out how to do a fucking government contract from the jump, an answer to every solution and know how I'm going to do this. No, like you get it. It gets thrown in your face and you adjust fire and you figure out how to fight, you know, what to do.
Yeah.
And when you first form something, your first iteration of it is going to look like a kindergartner's drawing. And then it's going to become a fucking beautiful piece of art eventually because you're going to get better and better and better. But you just start and then you build on it. And that's starting a company and bootstrapping a company up is just send it. Like you don't feel ready. You're not ready. Start doing it. That's how you learn. Yeah. Like you didn't, you not knowing equipment, audio, video, I guarantee you had to learn a wealth of information, dude.
Oh my gosh. What's funny now is it's kind of nice little pet to have. Even my own department is like, hey, can you piece together a video for us for this? Can you do that? And I'm like, oh, yeah, sure. Like, and it gets me out of doing whatever other little things that I was supposed to do that day. So,
what are you doing now with your police job? What is your position? What do you do?
I'm a detective and I work a property crimes team. So I'm kind of I'm a hybrid. I'm not a traditional detective that sits behind a desk and just gets a case and handles the case and does that. I have a team of officers that work with me. And basically what we'll do is I will take other property crime detectives' cases, get leads for them, then take the team out to the field and we'll do undercover work, buy bus, just go intel gather and UCs.
Property crimes? Like people buying prop? I don't understand.
So like, let's say your house gets burglarized, or your car's catalytic converter gets taken, or your business gets a bunch of copper wire stolen.
Got it.
Stuff like that. So we'll look into those, and we'll see, you know, your PlayStation 4 is one of the things that gets taken out of your house. So
you got to track down, you got to track down the neighborhood meth head. And then
Sometimes it's organized crime. That's always fun to get into. You start like catalytic converters. That's most of the time. That's not a doper. That's an organized institution. Mm. Yeah, big time.
Interesting. I would have thought that it was just a guy trying to get $250.
No. Oh, you're highly undervaluing your catalytic converter. because like an F-250. Yeah. Just depending on the year, but those go for $800. It's going to take some 30 seconds to get off your truck.
Jeez.
Yeah. And then you got Priuses. Now the Prius, you got to work a little bit more because you got to jack the vehicle up, but in under a minute, they'll take both catalytic converters off there, and they've just made about $4,000.
What are they going to do when all these vehicles are electric?
Steal the battery.
Steal the lithium ion.
Yeah. As I say, the battery's probably worth a lot of money. I heard somebody try to get their Chevy Volt battery replaced, and it was $27,000. They were quoted.
I was seeing something with some issues with the Teslas that, I think I saw it on TikTok. This guy was pissed. So he's like relentlessly making videos about his brand new Tesla that took a shit. And the engineers designed something with something that's a cooler, or, you know, it cools the batteries down or something, but it would leak water directly on the battery, apparently, he said, and it causes the battery to fail. And then the car becomes completely inoperable and the battery doesn't work. And then they don't warranty it, their own engineering mistake, from what I heard. I don't know.
Really?
And then this guy's pissed, and he's like, they quoted him X, like you said, for that Chevy Volt battery. Whatever. So he's just crazy. The car was a complete throwaway.
Yeah.
Like, don't ever buy this. I was like, I've looked around some of those Teslas, you know, and like felt their build quality. And I'm not impressed. They're fast, right? They're fast as fuck. But like, I don't want to go fast as fuck in a plastic thing that's vibrating, you know? I'm not ready to jump on that electric train yet, dude.
Yeah. Now, don't get me wrong. If somebody was like, here, have a Tesla, I'd be like, hell yeah. But no, I'm not going to go out and buy it. They're still in their infancy, really, when you think about it. Car creators have been making cars they've got it down, where Tesla's still tweaking. And do I think they make a cool product? Yeah, for sure. But the quality standards are going to have to adjust. And they're new to the car game. So
If you ask that dude on TikTok about Tesla, man, he'll let you have it.
I bet.
He spent so much money and that thing took a turd on him.
So. Yeah. Yeah. Their customer service, I've heard good things about, but then there's always these lemon cases that come out. And
yeah,
you know, there's two sides of every story. You're only hearing his one account. I would love to know like what the business side's actually telling him. Because look, he's probably got famous. He's probably making a shitload on TikTok.
Yeah.
By causing controversy.
True.
You know what I mean? I got some questions for you, sir, that I know people are going to want to hear about dogs. I want to get into dogs specifically. So, people, you know, you got your pets versus your guard dogs, and then people that try to have that in between. In my police work, this is what I've found. A lot of guys want to have the best of both worlds. And for you, like, let's get into the Belgian Malinois right off the go. Do you recommend them as a family pet?
I would only recommend them as a family pet to a person that puts the time and effort into educating themselves about high drive dogs, like knowing what high drive means. The word
I was going to say, can you explain that?
Knowing that dog, you know, a drive is a motivating factor to do. To hunt, to acquire food, to chase after things. So, you know, there's hunt drive, there's prey drive, there's play drive, there's all these different drives. It's a motivating factor. And a lot of it has to do with genetics of the animal. And those genetics on some animals can get watered down through overbreeding, inbreeding, mixed breeding. And those drives can be diminished or increased through breeding practices. So a high prey drive dog is a dog that it doesn't consciously think of the drive when the drive happens. It's kind of like your car switching to four-wheel drive at no notice because it senses that the ground is changing. So it imagine if the car switched immediately to four-wheel drive or it switched to like haul ass mode. It doesn't think about it. It's just, it's programmed to do it, right?
Yeah. Involuntary response.
So the dog sees a squirrel take off running in its peripheral or in its direct vision. It can't even think or resist to not pursue and put on chase. That's prey drive. Hunt drive is your drive to keep searching for something. So some dogs will tirelessly, a lot of labs and hunting dogs that are genetically bred to search for game, and they won't give up until they find it. So that's one of the things that we look for in bomb dogs is their hunt drive paired with prey drive. You want to have a balance of both. You want a dog that's going to continue to be motivated to look because it needs to get that gratification of catching or finding whatever it's looking for. Dogs that don't have drive that make good pets is they don't have no drive to do shit. They just want to lay around. You know, squirrel takes off running. It's like, I ain't going to chase you.
Yeah.
You know, so
I get that bitch. I ain't got to worry about you.
and that could be, you know, at very old age, a dog's drive will diminish that genetic drive to chase just because it can't. It's so old and tired that it's not able to do that. But a high drive dog will be an active dog all through its life. Until the very last days that it can't perform or it has hip dysplasia, it has different issues. So the high drive Malinois dog could be a good pet for a very active, educated individual. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah. I see it so often. Cops get a Malinois, other people get Malinois.
They're not active educated.
Yeah,
they could, even if you're only one of those tiers, let's say you're just active, but you're not educated, the dog's going to drive you fucking crazy. You don't know how to train. You don't know how to correct. You don't know anything about, being a handler of this high drive dog because you can't be a passive pet owner when you own one of these creatures. Yep. You have to be proactive instead of reactive. You need to be controlling that animal and setting the parameters of how it needs to behave, correcting it, rewarding it, training it, giving it mental stimulation, interaction. And people are lazy and they don't even have the discipline to fucking take care of themselves. So how are they going to take care of this high drive animal?
Yeah.
So no, it's a nightmare for the vast majority of people that think they want to get them. That's why throughout different states where there's higher population densities, these dogs are being all sent to the pounds and the shelters because they think that they want the John Wick dog off the movie and then they get the dog and then they end up sending it to a shelter to get fucking killed. Yeah. So if you're watching this and you know somebody's going to get one of those dogs and they're not a responsible, active, and educated individual, don't go get them. You have no business. The bottom of the line of the story is any working breed, German Shepherd, Belgian Malinois, Rottweiler, even labs.
I got Dobermans.
Yeah, labs, Dobermans. Fuck. Oh my God, they're so stubborn. They don't want to listen. You know, that don't get one of those dogs if you're not going to put the effort and you're not going to educate yourself and you're not going to give that dog what it needs. You don't have any place owning one of those dogs. That's my opinion. And I'm very strong on it because they're just getting, it's not fair that they get a shitty human that can't give them what they need and then they live a terrible life.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
But on the same thing it constitutes is the amount of money in this industry with breeding, overbreeding and puppy milling and people pumping out dogs for money because the dog game is a big money game, dude. There's so much money in this dog stuff. It's unreal. So you can't stop the people from producing the dogs. Somebody's got to buy them. Where are they going to go? Right.
Yeah.
So it's like, there's no stopping this, but I think the mass education, if most people that even don't know about dogs, but they hear someone talk about, oh, don't get a Belgian Malinois while they're too crazy. It'll be good for the breed, you know?
Yeah.
And then if there's not a supply and demand, then the breeders will produce them less. But, here I am I own another business called the Working Dog Classifieds, where I advocate ethical breeding and purpose-driven breeding. So, and then I created a platform for all different businesses, trainers, and breeders to post their working dog breeds, the high drive crazy ones, you know, on one platform that everybody can go and find. So this is the Working Dog Classifieds right there. If you scroll down. Yeah.
So if you're listening to the podcast, I recommend you tune in to the YouTube channel or the Rumble channel. And we are showing, I'm going to be showing Shane's Bellum Canine website. And right now we're showing the Working Dog Classified website. And Shane's going to explain all of that. So let me get your name off of here. And all right, go ahead. So
the Working Dog Classifieds, I mean, there's sections on here for regular pets as well, and even little dogs and stuff. But it's overall, you know, approved, ethical, good quality breeders and companies that have provable track records, and they pay to be a part of this website. All of the proceeds of the website come from the people listing the dogs, and we in return support those people. So like right here, you can see this Belgian Malinois through Alpha Canine Imports. These they're producing police dogs, right? So if you're a police agency or anybody looking for dogs for your department, I have built the hub for all the companies to come together and list their dogs. So, you know, all these police agencies across the United States, my goal is to get them to find out about this website so that they can find dogs for their departments. People like me that can find dogs for their clients. Let's say you have a high net worth client that needs a personal protection dog, right? Because he runs a cash-based business and he wants to have that added level of defense of his business. You can find the breeders. Let's say you're a hunter right here. These are hunting dogs that I think there's.
This is what I had. That's why I went to him. I had a German short hair before we got our
Doberman. Yeah, German short hair, or he has. I mean, I think there was a Springer Spaniels on there too. And you could find the hunting dog of your choice on there. There's geolocation, so you can see where they're located. You can click on that guy's profile, Phil Welchester. A little bit below that, you see his name. So if you click on that, I'm sure that'll pull up his profile. Shows you where he's located, his information, how long he's been, and you just go direct. You go direct with the sellers. I really created the Facebook of dog sales. Reinvented it because you can't sell dogs on Facebook without getting banned. You can't sell dogs on Craigslist, and if you do sell dogs on Craigslist, the people aren't approved and they're probably sketch. You know, so I created the Working Dog Classifieds to help people sell their dogs and get the dogs into the homes that they need to go to. You know, these high drive dogs, so that like a police department can come across and find it. And I felt from my experience, some of the police departments don't even know where to search to find the best dogs, or maybe they've just been working with one guy and they don't know, well, where else can we go to get some better ones? You know, well, here I built the website. And there's all these people, and I built it to help people. I built it to help all of these trainers. I built it to help the whole dog industry so that trainers can get business and their companies can get money. The breeders can make money, and it's not, none of these are people that are just pumping dogs out endlessly, you know?
Yeah.
Most of these are all you know, provable companies, people that are, you know, good trainers and stuff like that.
Yeah. Is there a rating system? Is there like a...
Yes. So on everybody's personal profile, so like that Canine Imports, like click that one. Who's that? I think that's Vaughn, Von der Allen. Oh, that's Blessing Knighting. So she's a trainer out in Florida. But let's say you did business with her, you could leave a review. There's something on there. I can't see where it says, but like... You can leave a personal review. I also have a blue verified check mark on her profile saying like she is trustworthy, she is credentialed, she knows what she's doing.
Okay.
You know, to a degree, you know, I own the company, so I kind of play God. I get to prove and disapprove people, but like,
right.
I'm not picking favorites. It's just, you either run an ethical, like it's business. If you run a good business, you treat your customers right. And I can see your work, you know, you get that verified check mark. She cranks out some amazing dogs, dude.
That's a beautiful one right there.
Yeah. And it shows you that that dog is sold.
Yep.
So,
gorgeous.
But yeah, so this is a great website. I really hope that it helps the whole working dog community as a whole, and it helps agencies, yeah. It helps private security companies locate the trainers that need to get the business.
Yeah. You
know? And because there's so many guys that like will build such a badass dog and then they sit on it for so long trying to find someone to buy it. So I just wanted to connect buyers to sellers and build that platform. Yeah.
No, that's dude, it's super smart and it's very clean. I like the way it looks. And like me personally, I would have never known. I would have went to my agency and talked to my canine handlers and been like, hey, where do I get a protection dog at? Like that's the best I got.
Now I built it, man. And I do need help, getting this out to the world. You know, I was sending out a bunch of free t-shirts to everybody. I'm starting to run out, you know, I only got so much money that I can bootstrap with and start. I spent like almost $1,000 in t-shirts to just send them out to people.
Gotcha.
But we're trying to launch this from nothing. And I hope word of mouth, we also have an Instagram and a Facebook page connected to this. So on the Instagram and stuff, we constantly post, that's the Bellum Canine, Instagram. Yeah. But if you type in the Working Dog Classifieds, it'll pull up that company's Instagram and you'll see how we promote all of our, people that list their dogs. So we're trying to help them sell their dogs. There's t-shirts I made. We're doing raffles. I'm about to give out this raffle. You see all that stuff that's in that raffle. That's about $1,000 in equipment that I'm just going to give away to random people.
Very cool.
So, you know, I'm trying to build it the best we can and support the members of the page. So like it's free for the world to go shop on the page, but the page makes its money from the people selling the dogs, right?
Right. Get a percentage of the sale.
You pay to post your ads.
Right. Oh, that makes sense.
So it's a $22 a month if you've got dogs to sell. You join it, and you know, $22 a month isn't that much. It's a couple cups of coffee, basically. And it's also, you know, helps your business because, like, if you know anything about SEO, search engine optimization, if you've got more ads and pages linking to your company name, you're going to get found. So, that's the goal too, is that someone searches for somebody's, company and then it pulls up the Working Dog Classifieds page that you're paying $22 a month for.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Hella Canines, all these people that pay, you know, they pay $22 a month to, be a listed vendor on the website. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. No, dude, this is genius. I mean, oh, look at that.
Yeah. That's Muzz. They do some awesome work.
That's cool.
So we're getting up there, man. I just with running Bellum Canine, I've been spread a little thin, so I can't be as active on it. Bellum Canine is my training company that I've had since 2017. It's the company that I did the government contract with. I'm located in Santa Fe, Texas, which is 45 minutes south of Houston and 30 minutes north of Galveston. So I'm in between Galveston and Houston. We're on rural country land. We have 3 acres of property in basically it's an unincorporated area where we don't have, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? We don't have like codes and stuff. So it's the country. We can do what we want out here.
Yeah.
I have 3 kennel buildings. 2 of them are fully operational. The other is still being finished with construction. So I currently have a 16 dog kennel capacity, and the kennels are climate controlled and AC'd, you know, and they're insulated. We have a training building that's like 2,500 square feet where we train the dogs in with all sorts of gear, equipment, scent walls, stuff. I mean, I have a facility built to be able to train service dogs, bomb dogs, drug dogs, people's pets. I do everything and anything at the time period to do what's best for the company. So if a government contract pops up, I scale to go do that. You know, if a concert needs a couple bomb dogs, I have bomb dogs that are, retained under my company. We'll go run those bomb dogs for the concert and private security. I actively train people's pets every single day, board and train them. So we're running a full staffed facility here. At my residence. And my goal is to scale it big enough, and then I'm going to move out, and this whole property and house and everything will be, it will be the premier dog training facility in all of South Texas. That's my vision.
Okay. Well, let's do this. Hey, we got a commercial on here. I just want to play it. If you're listening, you'll be able to hear it. But still recommend you go and check out the either the podcast, or you can go directly to the website, and it's the first video that you see on there. So I'm gonna pop this up here.
And that video is a little old. We're gonna do another one here soon.
Okay. Well, let's get this going here. And got the dramatic music going here.
Hi, I'm Shane McNamara, owner of Bellum Canine Incorporated. I want to welcome you here to Santa Fe, Texas at my training facility. At my location, we offer all sorts of training for different breeds. We also do protection training, service dog training, and even have online courses. I encourage you to sign up today.
I like it. It's pretty sweet, bro.
Yeah, that's an old video.
Today we're gonna go on.
Oh, there we go.
That's an old video. The training building isn't even fully set up. You know, I had just constructed that building. The kennels weren't completed. We were doing a lot of private training at that time instead of boarding and training. So we're about to reshoot a new video of all of our fleet, our equipment. I don't know. You saw that? Can you pull up that van that's on my Instagram? We just had that freaking sweet van wrapped under Bellum Canine. So we've been building our fleet. Like I said, I've been investing like every dollar into. That's while it's getting done. The other one, go to the other one. Yeah, there it is. It's fully completed. Yeah, we were out there. Hazel wanted to get in the van. He's like, oh, you want to go to training? You want to do some training? But yeah, that van is pretty sweet, and we use that van to transport dogs to Tractor Supply, Home Depot, Lowe's to do public training and stuff for environmental training. You know, so we got a bunch of Roughland kennels that are in there. Roughland, they're some of like the best kennels that I like to use. They're really strong. I don't get a dime for supporting them, but they're the kennels that I use in there. So we just load the dogs up, bring them to Tractor Supply, train in public. And it's really cool. So,
dude, you should.
The new video is going to be kick ass. When we do the new video, it's going to be awesome. You're going to see everything we got going on here.
Okay, you should do I like that you put on training things at local stores and whatnot. But like here in Arlington, we take our dogs to the dog park occasionally, and it'd be cool to see your van just parked out and just showing people dog behaviors and stuff that you're seeing while you're watching and.
Yeah, that's the whole other side, man. After doing this for years, you know, I'm a little burned out with the human side, the human beings. Like, I'm not a pro dog park person because you've got all these untrained pets running around and dog fights and liabilities and.
Yeah, that makes sense,
dude. It's not a good place. It's not a fun place, but it is a good place to park the van to drive business to the company for sure. Because they has got so many bad dogs that are not bad dogs, but untrained dogs out there that you know, need to be trained. That's a an online dog training course that I put on. It's a modules based. So for 14, I think it's $14.99 a month, you can pretty much get a good portion of the Lackland's program of education online. So that's my dog training course that's online. A lot of people are distance from me. They can't travel to me, have us train their dogs, but they could learn through the dog training course and be a part of a community. And I'm selling it for dirt cheap, like $14 a month. Here's all your knowledge. You just go do it. Get out there. I wanted to make it affordable for everyone to have high-end education of dog training.
Yeah. And if you're going to have the dog, man, you got to do the, you got to do the research, do the homework, figure it out, know what's best. And that's actually, and
you see how really many irons, how many irons I have in the fire, man. I'm like a serial entrepreneur. Like now my phone is blowing up and the world is burning down for being on a podcast.
I bet. I've heard the vibration go off a few times.
I'm sorry. Getting emails and stuff. I haven't heard from you. It's been 12 hours. You're supposed to send me an invite to get my dog booked. Listen, lady, I'll be there shortly.
Yeah. Just like you, man. I get constantly bombarded and people asking me to do stuff that I hadn't even considered, like doing a live event. And I'm like,
oh, live. Yeah.
I've never done a live event. So I'll be doing two live events actually. Fairly soon. So we'll see how that goes.
I'm excited to see the post editing of this and be able to promote both of us, you know, on all my channels too.
Yeah.
I'm excited and I'm thankful that you invited me to be on the show today. You know, it's the first podcast I've ever done. So,
oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, I'm working so hard and doing all these things, but I'm not that cool.
Yeah. Here's the way I look at it, man. Especially when, you know, the part of this show is to educate not just the public, which that's a major portion, but other officers, people considering getting in the military, people considering being a canine handler, trainer, all of that stuff. They're going to see your background, where you came from. They're gonna be like, oh, this dude, like his mom was a stripper and like he still was able to make something of his life using the military. Like that's a success story.
It came from the bottom.
And you still hit the highs and lows that we all go through. And we're able to talk about it and get through it and then look at the drive that you have now. It's a success story. It's a driving story. I think people need to hear these types of things. It's just like watching The Rock on Instagram and seeing him like crush the gym every morning at 4 a.m. And you're just like, all right, I'm being lazy. I need to go run. I need to do something.
You know, and that's the other thing that I want people to see that I just thought of while you were saying that is like, you know, Facebook and Instagram and everything that when people see me post, they see a highlight reel. They see me winning. All I do is win, right?
Yeah.
That's not the case, man. Like, I got down days. I got bad things. Like, you know, the businesses are hard. I have anxiety attacks. I'm stressed out, but I overcome adversity, you know, and you see me posting all these things that we're doing, but that's just because I don't give up.
Yeah.
So I want to motivate people as an influencer or a business owner to like let them know that not everything they see is going to be easy and you can get through it and just, you know, and then keep your circle with people like you and me, you know, that support each other, stay in touch and
you know. Yeah, that's all I want to do, especially when I have guests that have something to promote, like uses my platform. It's not the biggest, but it's growing, and just like you with your business, it's growing and getting bigger and bigger. You just got to keep plugging away at it.
Like I told you, I'm gonna manifest. It's gonna be the Galveston's premier dog training facility. We're gonna put on an amazing experience for everyone's pets here. And that's what I wanted to do. And then if there's other government contracts that pop up or things that need me, I'm a jack of all trades. I've tried to position myself to be like, when anybody says they need something done, they'd be like, I know a guy that can get it done.
Yeah.
You know? Call Shane. He'll figure it out.
Right. No, that makes perfect sense, buddy. That's a good goal to have. So anybody out there listening, just make sure you go to bellumcanine.com. You can find Shane on Instagram at bellumcanine inc. INC. I've got that on the screen if you're listening. What else are we missing?
Working dog classifieds.
Working dog classifieds. That's a place to buy and sell your dogs, which you can't do anywhere else. It's basically a one of a kind thing right now. Very cool. Anything else we haven't hit that you want to hit, buddy?
Yeah, I don't sell coffee anymore. Like I told you, we had a fall in and out. Right. I did have a coffee company for a while and it was taken off, but you know, things fell out with that supplier and I dumped it. I realized too that the coffee space, dude, was super saturated. Everybody's coming out with coffee of this and coffee of that. It's just,
yeah,
this is a saturated market, man.
Yep. Super saturated. I bought your coffee. I bought it. I had it. And then, it, like you said, the website kind of like, you just kind of dropped off the face of the earth 'cause you were doing your overseas stuff. But, I stick to Black Rifle, man.
Yeah. So do I, man. I'll stick to them. It's fine. I'm not going to do that, but I've got other things that are, I need focus on. And I guess another advice as an entrepreneur or businessman is don't spread yourself too thin on too many projects because you can't give love to all of them.
Yeah.
You know, I'm having to do Bellum Canine and this, and I can't give as much love to the Working Dog Classifieds. Or if I start working on the Working Dog Classifieds, my other business starts to suffer.
Yep.
This is a hard game, man.
Yep. I just getting merchandise. I was like, let me try some hats and some stickers. And that was too much.
It'll consume your time to make those and create it. And
yep.
But you're killing it, man. I'm so thankful that you invited me this morning. I've got to go attend all of these emergency texts and dog barking, and there might be a fire. I don't know. I've got to
go. Who knows? Oh, you're all right, buddy. Well, I appreciate you being on, bud, and I wish you the best of luck.
All right. Love you, brother. Take care.
I love you too, man. Take it easy.